time or alarms?
A longtime friend of Dave's and Chris. And I'm very honored to be a part of this celebration of his life. Fred Eugene Kickers passed away on Monday, March 27th, 2017. And today we celebrate his life. Time to remember him and share some great stories and eulogies about him and the dead. So welcome. Welcome to the celebration of his life. In the name of Jesus, as we gather together to remember before God and one another, my brother Fred, to give thanks for his life, to remember the times together with him, and to comfort one another in our loss. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our brother Fred. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in the pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless love, console us who mourn. Give us courage and faith and a sure hope that we may continue to have strength for the days ahead. O God of grace, make us certain that because Christ lives, we shall also live. And neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from God's love. A reading from Ecclesiastes. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek, a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. For everything, there is a season. And a time for every matter in the world. As I said before, I'm honored to be a part of this celebration of Fred. I think every time I saw him and that we met, Fred and I celebrated along with Debbie. He always was ready to grab my suitcase and take it upstairs. He knew exactly where my bedroom was. And then he'd come down and give me a big hug. And I'll never forget those days that I look forward to not only seeing Betty, but to be with Brett. This is an opportunity for us to share our good feelings and some of the happy times and maybe even some of those sad times that we remember so much about where Fred was in her life. And I want to begin to share my connection with Fred and Betty. Some of you already know that Betty and I grew up about a block away from each other. And we knew each other from the time we first started going to school. We entered junior high and we became closer. Betty found out that I didn't know how to play cards. And she said, "You've got to know how to play cards." And so that began an almost weekly get-together. Canasta, of course, began the game and was the game forever and still continues. Yeah, we played last night. We both went to the same high school, of course, and graduated. She's a couple years older than I am, but we're okay with that. I am at least. We went to Concordia and Moorhead. Again, she was a couple years over there, but and at that time, Fred was at Moorhead State. The first time I really actually got to know Fred was at that point because they were going together and we saw each other and she talked about him all the time. And one of the interesting things in that is that that fall, that first fall, Fred wanted to go to a young Democratic gathering in Bemidji. And he had asked Betty to go with him. Well, some of you are the same age as I am, and my parents, well, maybe not my parents' age, because I'm almost there, their age. But back in those days, there was this feeling that you needed a chaperone if you weren't married and was planning to spend time with your fiancé or your boyfriend someplace else. And so they were looking for a chaperone. And of all people, they chose me. After a wonderful pizza dinner that we had at a nice pizza place, we checked into the hotel and found out that the event was one where you would go from room to room to room, where the people who were wanting to be elected would have drinks and food and things like that. And so we decided to, of course, that's what Fred was there for, to get to know these people. And so we went from room to room to room to room to talk to these people who were wanted to be elected. And after we finished all of them, we didn't stay very long in each one of them because, you know, you can only say eat so much. We decided that we would try to do something else for the rest of the evening. And Fred decided that we should, guess what, play cards. He went downstairs to the lobby and he got rolls of pennies, like three of them, which was a total of $9. And so he wanted to play, guess what, poker. Betty didn't teach me poker. Neither did she really know much about poker. So Fred took this time to, just a little bit of time, to teach us what poker's all about. And because you know very well, if you know Fred at all, that, you know, he played poker all the time, and most of the time he won. In fact, Betty immediately told me, you know, he's the winningest poker player in his dormitory. Okay. So we started to play poker. And we played until one person hit all $9. Anyone have a guess as to who that person was?
It was me!
I had the $9 in my lap. I have teased him a lot after that. And we never played again. The next big event that we had together, the three of us, was, of course, it would be those two for sure, was their wedding. And it was, again, I was very happy and felt very humble about being in their wedding. And we, if I remember correctly, and my memory tends to, you know, go this way, it was a very wonderful wedding and very fun. Over the years, of course, Fred and Betty went one direction, and I went another direction. I think that I have stayed in every single house that they lived in, except for East Africa and New York. But when they moved back to the cities, we would get together often. And of course, the reason to get together was so that we could get back to Panasta. And so I would go to their home, and while Betty was running around doing this and doing that and getting ready to play Panasta, especially getting the bottle that we have to have for Panasta. You all know that there's a bottle that people use for Fred and I would talk. And we talked about many, many subjects. But the subject that surprised me the most that he wanted to talk about, and the questions he asked, were about religion, various beliefs, the Bible, the Quran, and theology and Christianity. His questions were not easy questions. He made me think very much. And we had very, very good conversations. He did his homework. We all know that Fred always did his homework, and then some. And each time we had the opportunity, we would pick up where we left off and continue talking, and he was continuing challenging me with questions and opportunities, and I relished that time together. I think as I look back at that time, I was an associate in ministry, and the more I talked to him, and the more questions he asked of me about what's about this and about that, helped me an awful lot to see Christianity, to see faith as something that opened my mind to understand how other people also looked at Christianity and how they believed and how they acted in terms of their beliefs as well. So in total, in that regard, he helped me an awful lot in my ministry. For some of you, that may surprise you, because Fred wasn't one to talk about his faith openly, but I know that he read scripture. I know that he had a lot of questions and really helped me understand more and more, as I said before. It was definitely a surprise to Betty, because when I told her about this, that's the conversations that Fred and I had, She said, what? But then she told me that the song that he liked a lot was Amazing Grace, and that he wanted this song to be sung here today. And we will hear it shortly. Annie and Kevin and Rebecca will be sharing that. And inside your booklet or your brochure or program, you will find copies of the hymn. And the those who are singing, standing over there, would like to have you please respond with singing together at the end, singing together the first verse. They'll sing it once, and then we all will come in secondly. And then after that, those who wish to share information about Fred or a eulogy or some situation where they enjoyed or run into all sorts of different fun things or bad things, whatever it might be, then please raise your hand or something, and you come up here and share that eulogy with us as we talk about the fun, even though Fred always didn't look like he was happy. Until I came. So, and if we have so many people who wish to share, and it's 11:30, we're going to be going across the room and eat. And so if you have not shared, or if you thought of something in the process, please feel free to share at the table as well. Try to keep it within 10 or 15 minutes, that would be great. Otherwise, we probably not only have lunch here, but we have dinner and breakfast. So if you can do that, fine. If not, I understand fully, because we all have that wonderful thought of more and more about that. So who is willing to begin?
God, Fred, that influenced my life. Fred was a humorist and a great storyteller. Fred had a great sense of humor. He introduced me to Pogo. To me, the best comic is still ever created. I take out a book from my Pogo collection when I need a laugh. Fred was also an actor. He had the lead role in several high school plays. And when he went to Morehead State, he thought he would work in theater, building sets, or whatever behind the scenes work. But he ended up with a lead role in that production. Fred's sense of humor and acting ability made him a great storyteller. Back when people still used 35mm slides, you remember those. The common joke was when the host brings out the slides of their latest vacation, people yawn and say, "It's time to go home." But Fred's slideshows were both interesting and entertaining, as he would give animated narration of story after story about each slide. His description of he and Betty bashing across the African savanna and a VW bug chasing a herd of wildebeest always got laughs. It could really take you there. Fred had determination, and he demonstrated that in many ways throughout his life. One of the first examples that I can remember was when Fred was 16 years old. He rode his bike from our farm to our cousin Sue, Beth and Sue's house in St. Cloud, about 70 miles. This was the 1950s, and as many of you know, the road to St. Cloud was Highway 55. There was no bike lane, and Fred did not have a fancy racing bike. Ours was a single-speed, basic beater of a bike. We never talked about it, but I'm sure he rode the 70 miles back a few days later. Until that age, Fred had been overweight. After that, he exercised regularly and was not overweight for the rest of his life. That bike ride is an example of the determination that Fred applied to many things that he wanted to accomplish. Fred did not want to end up on the farm or stuck in some boring job after high school. He saw college as the way out and worked hard enough and earned enough money so he could go. Of course, it may also be that he wanted away from the crowd. Six kids and mom and dad in a very small house. When Fred visited the house years later, his comment to me was, "You can't raise six kids in a house that size." Fred put a very high value on education, and his determination to get a college degree helped his brothers and sisters see that they could do the same. When I was a sophomore in high school, he gave me a copy of Gulliver's Travels and inscribed it, "Alan, I hope you read this now and again when you enter college." Because of Fred's example, it never occurred to me not to go to college. Fred also loved travel. In addition to formal education, Fred believed in the educational value of travel and shared many of his experiences. Over the years, he and Betty traveled the world, near and far. When we were in high school, Fred and Betty took Genevieve and me on a trip to Chicago, where we saw the Hayden Planetarium. For me, it was an absolutely amazing show. Of course, Fred, always teaching, explained how the machine worked that made the display of the night sky. As we arrived in Chicago, we stopped at an Oasis, a restaurant built to span the tollway. I could hardly believe that we were eating and watching traffic and the tollway speed under us. This was one of the many experiences Fred made possible that helped open our eyes to the world outside of London. I also learned that trips don't always work out as planned. On one memorable trip, Fred and Betty picked me up at about 10 p.m. on Friday night and drove all the night to Winnipeg to see the only walled city in North America. When we arrived, Fred pulled into a gas station and asked the attendant where we should go to see the wall. The attendant looked very puzzled and said, "What ball?" Turns out Fred had been watching some travel show about Canada and didn't realize the subject had changed from Winnipeg to Quebec. Fred enjoyed taking opportunities to teach others what he learned. He had the ability to explain how complicated things work, like that device in the planetarium that displayed the sky. Many of us, including nieces and nephews, have had the experience of talking with him about some aspect of our work. Even though we all did jobs quite different from his, he could analyze the situation and offer insightful ideas that often helped us better understand the issue we were dealing with. He also enjoyed teaching management to college students at St. Cloud State on a temporary assignment. And in spite of the commute, was disappointed when the assignment ended. I think we'd like to just keep teaching that. Of course, like travel, teaching didn't always work out as planned. Fred decided he should not complain about the quality of teaching in public schools unless he could prove how easy it was. He became a substitute teacher in the Minneapolis school system and was given an assignment to a fifth grade class. He lasted 2 days. One of the more dramatic problems that occurred was when one of his students set fire to a roll of paper towels in the bathroom. Fred's comment about the incident was that the principal was not nearly as upset as Fred thought he should be. Fred was determined never to stay in a job that did not offer opportunity to further develop his skills. He liked to challenge himself. Although he had real success in chemistry, including the opportunity to work in East Africa for a couple of years, he realized that there was no long-term future for him in that profession. So he went back to college, got an MBA, and worked for a number of years as a CPA at B. Marwick. After mastering that job, he realized that the best path for him was as a manager. He left B. Marwick and went on to be a chief financial officer of several firms over the years. The capstone of Fred's management career was also the job I think he was most proud of. Our younger brother Jim was having trouble keeping his company, K&J Woodworks, profitable. He was busy, but often that didn't result in profit, and Jim didn't know why. Fred revamped the accounting system so that Jim could understand what jobs made profit and which didn't. At this point in his career, Fred had revamped accounting systems at several companies, so that was not a new challenge. The new challenge was an open book management approach that Fred was convinced would help develop a highly motivated workforce. He had tried to implement this at several companies he'd worked at, but had been unable to convince the owners. Jim agreed to adopt this system so that all the managers received all the financial information about the company, including how much the boss was paid. Managers all knew which jobs were profitable and why, and all employees shared in the profit. The result was that at the time of Jim's untimely death, he left behind a very successful company that continues to thrive. Fred was a storyteller, an educator, a traveler, and a powerful example of what can be accomplished with hard work and determination. Through sharing his life experiences, he expanded our view of the world and the possibilities available to all of us. At age 78, Fred had been whacked pretty hard, but he had a good life. Family, work, a sense of humor, and loyalty to the tribe. That was Fred. And no matter what, you always knew Big Brother was there for you. Most of all, Fred was a big brother we all looked up to. We miss you, Fred.
I really appreciate your comments. Would you take an extra piece of paper? so I get everything written down just like I did with my sermons.
My vision obviously is very good.
Well, that's okay. I have, it is 11:30, and I don't want to stop people from talking, because you didn't stop me, nor did you stop Alan. But in order for us to be, for the caterer to have food ready for us, we should probably have one more, if one more is short, and then we're going to turn it over to Betty. For the final, and then we will, for those who are looking at us and saying, singing, yes, we have a song, one last song on to us. So, does somebody have, and then of course everybody else, while we're eating, please share, because we want to hear your fun times, and like I say, interesting times, and what Fred has given us in his lifetime as well. So anybody have, oh, come on, I'm going to put this underneath here.
Hello, my name is Larry Crapo, and I've known Betty and Fred for ever. Okay, thank you. One of our fondest memories of Fred was some 40 years ago, when Betty and Fred were at our home for dinner. Our then 5-year-old daughter was invited Fred to join her in playing an Atari video game called Air Sea Battle. The game involved using a joystick to shoot down various things that came across the screen. Fred agreed to play the game with her, so they both sat on the floor in front of the TV. The game began, and my 5-year-old had a great familiarity with the game and beginning to gun down everything that came across the screen. Fred was trying desperately hard to learn how to lead the object and to shoot, the various targets. Well, the game went on for a bit with the 5-year-old's score quite high and Fred struggling to hit anything he could, but not to much avail. The cheery little 5-year-old then looked up at Fred, beaming with excitement and a big smile, and said, "Having fun, Fred?" Well, Fred's intense attempt to master the game melted into a hearty laugh, which we all joined in. We definitely will miss Ted's inquisitiveness and his fun, loving spirit.
Ready?
I will try to keep this short, but there are no guarantees. I am going to shorten it because Alan covered a lot of what I was going to say. I first of all want to thank my childhood friend, Murray O'Leary. Murray. Like she indicated, we've been friends since we were kids. And Fred would have been absolutely thrilled with your service today. Thank you so much. We go back a long ways, and she holds a very special place in my heart. I would like to thank the Garrity Delmar Funeral Home for the wonderful facilities they provided us here today, along with thanking Carrie Lee Garrison for everything she's done to assist me in planning this event, which I think is very special for Fred. The music today has been provided, as you know, by Kevin Murtel, who is my nephew, and Annie Davis, who is my niece, and they are accompanied by Rebecca Addington. Beautiful voices, great harmonizing and inspirational songs. At this time, I want to thank Fred's entire family for their support during these last several months, which have been very difficult and hard on all of us. But I especially want to thank all of you for coming out today to share in Fred's life. And I want to thank you for your cards, your emails, and your phone calls, all of which spoke of deep concerns and caring thoughts. And those four words deep concerns and caring thoughts, they really only say and explain one word, and that word is love, for which I thank you, and which really makes our world go around. Fred is deeply loved by many people and will be missed by many people on many different levels for many different reasons. So as we leave here today, please keep him in your minds, in your hearts, and in your prayers. Thank you. And I'm now going to turn over to Maria.
I have just a few announcements before we get into the song. Some of you will probably notice as you go from this room into that room that there's some other boxes by the door. You all know that, especially if you are a Kickers, that one of the favorite things, and somebody said it should be made into a separate food, all by itself, is popcorn. And so we have a gift of popcorn for all of you as you leave. We promised the funeral home that you will not bring it in here at open. So there's popcorn out there, and so as you leave, take one, take two. I think we have enough for even taking three. My bedroom is now popcorn free. But please don't bring it inside. There are some t-shirts out there that, as you know too, Fred saved, bought and saved and stored t-shirts. And so the t-shirts that are out there, if you are a niece or a nephew or a grandchild, somewhere along the line, please take a t-shirt and it'll be a remembrance. I know I tried one on, on grandchildren and other young children, you could grow into them and have them. There's also some sweaters there that Betty Betty, that's good connection, isn't it?
Yeah.
That Betty has already decided who they should go to. So see Betty if that's the case. We have some other announcements when we get in for lunch. The last song is Whispering Hope. And this one, I've got to remember the person. This is the not the last verse, but
the chorus,
yes, that we would like to have you sing. And then when that's over, follow the family out to the dining area. And so before we do that, I will close with one. Oh God, again, we thank you for the gift of Fred in our lives. He left many, many memories for each of us during his lifetime. We also thank you for this opportunity to share the memories at the celebration. Continue to surround Betty and the family of Kickeridges throughout this time. And God, we thank you for this food that will be set before us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Okay, like.